These are particles of radioactive fallout. And this is how a single particle looks magnified several hundred times. A radioactive piece of matter from a nuclear explosion. These few particles can't do us any significant harm. But should there be a nuclear attack, many billions of them would fall from the sky and settle to Earth, releasing radiation that could cause sickness or death in the area where they fall. To begin with, it may be surprising to know that radiation is something we live with every day. Far back in time, back before there was an Earth, there were flaming fireballs in space. We call them stars. And there are millions upon millions of them. Each star, like our own sun, is a raging nuclear furnace that shoots out showers of particles too tiny to be matter as we conceive it, along with invisible forces that we call radiation. This radiation and these particles travel through space at fantastic speeds until they strike some other matter, which may make new flares of radioactivity. They strike wandering asteroids, moons, and planets such as our own. Everything in space, Earth included, receives this radiation.
Sky is partly cloudy this afternoon, clearing but.
Background radiation is all around us in tiny quantities. Nature even planted unstable atoms deep inside the Earth itself. They decay one by one, here and there, in a barrage of inconceivably small and silent explosions. Each explosion is another spark of radiation. All life on Earth has reached its present form in company with radiation from this naturally occurring radioactivity. Extremely thin, with extremely low-level intensity, it has always been with us. It is nothing new. We don't worry about the small amounts of natural background radiation. But to safely handle larger amounts, we must keep our distance and shield ourselves. For, as the amounts increase, so do the dangers. The amount of energy generated by a nuclear explosion is enormous. Near the crater area, there is almost total destruction from blast and heat. And now, large amounts of pulverized debris and molten earth are pulled up into the mushroom cloud. This is where radioactive fallout is formed. The radioactive atoms produced in the explosion join with the particles of earth and debris. The mushroom-shaped cloud forms and climbs higher. It now contains billions of highly radioactive particles of matter that we call fallout. The strong winds of the upper altitudes go to work on the cloud, blowing it off in one or more directions. Gravity tugs on the particles. The larger and heavier ones sink toward the ground, while the lighter particles continue to drift with the wind. Some of the lightest particles remain suspended in the upper atmosphere. As time passes, their radioactivity grows weaker, so that the longer they remain aloft, the less dangerous they are. But the heavier particles, spread by high-altitude winds, fall to the ground within 24 hours. Several miles from the explosion, they are about the size of table salt or fine sand. These are the most dangerous, because they carry the greatest number of radioactive atoms and so emit the largest amount of nuclear radiation. Which brings us to an all-important fact. Deadly as radiation can be. And this gives us an invaluable ally. Time. Suppose a nuclear explosion takes place at 12 noon. By 1 o'clock, the total force of the residual radiation is at a high level. By 7 o'clock, it's down to 1/10. In 2 days, although still dangerous, it's only 1/100th. But in 2 weeks, it's only 1/1000th. With this decay rate in mind, consider radioactive fallout conditions which might confront us after a massive attack. Within an hour, fallout would be a serious problem in the vicinity of explosions which occur on or near the ground. By 7 hours after the attack, the fallout area covers more and more of the country as the prevailing winds expand the fallout in a downwind pattern. 24 hours. 48 hours. Without shelter, millions would face death. A few days later, those who have taken shelter will survive. In many areas, people can even leave shelter for brief periods of time to carry out important tasks. Within 2 weeks, most people...
On July 19th, the D-Day of Operation Crossroads, the atomic bomb supervised by Vice Admiral Blandy at Bikini Atoll in mid-Pacific. Crews leave the target ships in Bikini Lagoon, many for the last time. The B-29, Dave's Dream, takes off from Kwajalein to deliver the bomb, equal to 50,000 tons of TNT, while an electric metronome counts the final seconds. Cover your eyes. Now... away! A deadly radioactive cloud rises over 7 miles. Cloud ships are tangled wrecks. The battleship Nevada is towed into position for the second test, Test Baker. King Judah of Bikini watches with Admiral Blandy as LST-60 moves into place. The bomb is suspended beneath LST-60 and is to be fired by remote control. The technicians and Vice Admiral Parsons leave LST-60 and the bomb. At the control room, Crossroads personnel are checked, then locked in. Dr. Holloway, Los Alamos director, readies the firing circuit.
30 seconds before 8th hour.
Cameras are ready aboard ship and in the sky.
Two, one, fire.
The force that can destroy our world unless we find the road to peace now.
Town atom test measured a model village in the Nevada desert against the awesome power of nuclear energy. Buildings of various materials went up. $1 million worth of equipment was installed, including lifelike mannequins and tons of food to measure the contamination caused by radiation. The big dolls were Survival Town's sole inhabitants. Tanks took part in their first atomic maneuvers, some less than a mile away, the closest yet in any test. Nearly 6,000 persons participated, including troops sheltered by trenches. Many cameras in many locations filmed the single blast. In the desert held vital information on how to survive an enemy attack. With Geiger counters to check the radiation, experts assessed the damage. An aluminum building was left a gaping wreck. Concrete or cinder blockhouses weathered the blast best. This one was less than a mile away. Survival Town's electric wires have become a twisted, tangled mass. Demonstrating the importance of civil defense preparedness, the elaborate exercises proved survival is possible, offering new hope to all who live in the shadow of the atomic age. On the sandy wastes at Yucca Flat, Nevada, a new series of atomic explosions are set off. Tanks are among the obsolete pieces of Army equipment being tested in the exercises called Operation Teapot. More than 9,000 servicemen have been assembled at the proving grounds, ready to take their places in forward trenches. In a grim new age of warfare, today's fighting men must be taught survival on an atomic battlefield. While the troops take cover, the Army's giant new 100-inch camera is pointed toward the blast tower. Men tensely eye the control booth as the seconds tick off. Familiar mushroom cloud snakes skyward, hurling the atom's deadly radiation high into the heavens. The sound and shockwaves roll over the men huddled in the trenches. Never before have we had such a close-up view. lighting up the desert skies for miles around, the fierce fireball flare is the signal for instant action. Quickly, the men are ordered to leave their positions. The explosion's radioactive fallout is almost as dangerous as the blast itself. In the vitally important precaution of dusting each other off, the lowly broom becomes an item of military significance. Next, Geiger counters are used to check the troops for signs of radioactivity. Marching out of the shadow of the awesome fighting men, symbolizing America's determination to keep...
Clicking sounds, sounds that reveal the presence of radioactive waves. The instrument, a Geiger counter, is converting radioactivity into sounds we can hear. This radioactivity is coming from a small piece of radioactive material inside this plastic cylinder. The small amount of radioactivity coming from the cylinder is harmless. The luminous dial on this watch also gives off radioactive rays, which we hear on the Geiger counter. Even when there's no radioactive material near, the Geiger counter continues to click. This is caused by cosmic radiation that continually bombards us from outer space. But we don't get enough cosmic radiation to harm us. Today, atomic scientists produce radioactivity in large amounts. Radioactivity and radioactive materials have many peacetime uses. But we know, too, that they can be used harmfully, as in atomic bombs. The chance of your being hurt by an atomic bomb is slight. But since there is a chance, you must know how to protect yourself. To protect yourself, you have to know what the bomb does. Besides blast, there's radioactivity and heat. Can we protect ourselves from these? These children are protected. Concrete walls help stop radioactivity. Any wall stops the heat. The heat scorches the house, but does not harm the children. Any solid gives some protection. The thicker it is, the better. We have the national defenses to intercept an enemy, and we all form a team to help each other through emergencies. You are on that team. So is your family, each member of it. And in your community, every doctor, fireman, every policeman and nurse, every lineman and operator, every civil defense worker, in fact, every community employee is ready to help you if you need him. So your community is prepared for emergencies and ready to help other communities. We have state and national headquarters for civil defense. And your city has a civil defense corps. We have a warning system and a system of defense. Yes, we have the equipment and the people for an effective team. But, like any team, it can win only when everyone knows his job and does it well. What is your job? What if a warning siren sounds? What should you do? Look for cover, the nearest cover. Don't try to make it home unless home is the nearest place to go. Don't hesitate. Find cover. Everyone is in on this. Strangers will understand. Finding shelter quickly may save your life. If you can't get into a house, get behind a wall or a steep embankment on the side away from the city. Civil defense teams will go into action immediately. If you're home, you've work to do.
Hi, Susie. Everything's fine upstairs. How are you doing here?
Okay, I guess.
That's good.
We repeat. Cover windows to protect against the possibility of broken glass, heat, and radioactivity. Turn off fires. If you are home and are not assigned to civil defense duties, go to your prepared shelter. Those who are in shopping centers, go to prepared shelters.
Oh, fire the kitchens out. Now we'll go down the basement.
In this practice alert, we are assuming that the attack will come on the waterfront area.
See, it's just practice. All this rushing around for nothing.
Now, there's just where you're wrong. We need this practice. Now, come on, let's do our job.
That's good thinking. We all need practice. Here's a clean, well-prepared shelter in the basement. Ted and Sue have a battery radio. And they have soda ash and stirrup pump fire extinguishers. They have other emergency supplies, too. A flashlight, a well-equipped first aid kit, with plenty of bandages, tape, and scissors. A Red Cross first aid book, a few cans of food, a good supply of water, blankets, and an electric lantern in reserve.
You know, Susie, this stuff would come in handy on a camping trip.
I'd a lot rather be on a camping trip. Say, what would they do if we didn't have a basement?
At school, they told us we should be away from windows and behind double walls. You know, like an inside hall.
Ted's right. If you live in an apartment house, you can't all go to the basement. Head for a shelter area. If none is marked for you, find cover away from windows and in a hallway if possible. Wait for the all clear. Be calm. If you're on the playground, run for shelter. If you're in the schoolyard, get into the building. Move quickly, but in good order. Inside, go to the shelter area you've been assigned. Take your place on the floor. Here's one good way to protect your eyes and neck in case of a bombing. Wait.
Dum, 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 deedle dum, dum, deedle dum, dum, deedle dum, dum. There was a turtle by the name of Bert, and the turtle was very alert. When danger threatened him, he never got hurt. He knew just what to do. He ducked and covered. And cover.
He did what we all must learn to do.
You and you
and you and you.
Duck, and cover.
Be sure and remember what Bert the Turtle just did, friends, because every one of us must remember to do the same thing. That's what this film is all about. Duck and cover.
This is an official civil defense film produced in cooperation with the Federal Civil Defense Administration and in consultation with the Safety Commission of the National Education Association.
Produced by Archer Productions, Incorporated. Hey, Bert, come on out and meet all these nice people, please. Oh, all right. We really can't blame you. You see, Bert is a very, very careful fellow. When there's danger, this is the way he keeps from being hurt. Sometimes it even saves his life. That's why these children are practicing to duck and cover just as you do in your school. We all know the atomic bomb is very dangerous. Since it may be used against us, we must get ready for it, just as we are ready for many other dangers that are around us all the time. Fire is a danger. It can burn whole buildings if someone is careless. But we are ready for fires. We have a fine fire department to put out the fire, and you have fire drills and...
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Looks like any other when you see it from an airplane window. Trees line the quiet residential streets, and there's usually a highway running through to an industrial area where many town people work. But in every town, you'll find houses like this, run down, neglected. Trash and litter disfigure the house and yard. An eyesore, yes, and as you'll see, much more. A house that's neglected is the house that may be doomed in the atomic age. What would happen to such a town if it were on the outer fringe of an attack directed at a nearby city? We can answer that question, in part at least, even though it hasn't happened yet. A series of civil defense tests were made to discover the effects of atomic heat on American homes. I am going to show you how protective measures can help guard your home against the heat effects of an atomic explosion. This is the Nevada Proving Ground, where tests were made on miniature houses in various stages of upkeep, inside and out. These tests were also made on common fire hazards, like dead grass, old leaves, discarded newspapers, and fence structures. Here are five fences placed far enough from the explosion that they could survive the blast. The fences in the middle are built of decayed wood. Dry grass and litter simulate conditions you've seen in too many alleys and backyards in slum areas. The trash, litter, and dead grass are perfect kindling for the unprotected and unpainted wood of the fence itself. The moments tick away as we await the bomb and the fireball. The light flash and the heat or thermal wave, then the blast wave. You remember the three middle fences are built of rotten wood, unpainted and surrounded by trash. They are immediately ignited. The two outer fences, without litter, are slower to ignite. Decayed, combustible wood surfaces like these fences are readily ignited by heat flash. Likewise, some types of interiors are easily ignited. This will be demonstrated in the next test. Here are two miniature frame houses, identical in structure, both in good condition and well painted outside. Sturdily mounted cameras in front of the houses are to record the effect of heat flash. Large windows purposely expose the interiors to the flash. In the house on the right, all the earmarks of untidy housekeeping. Newspapers and magazines lying about. And cluttered tables. Now the house on the left, identical to the other, but spick and span. Trash has been thrown away. Tabletops are tidy. Two homes, one a fire trap, even under ordinary conditions. The other cleaned up and fresh with better, safer housekeeping. Both ready for the test bomb. Light flash and the heat wave, then the blast tears away part of each roof. Let's see it again in stop motion. First, the light flash and the thermal or heat wave that only chars the painted outer surface of both houses. Then the blast. The cluttered room of the house on the right bursts into flame. In a few moments, the interior is completely ablaze. The fire that started inside spreads rapidly to the house itself, although the house on the left still shows no exterior flames. Now the house on the right burns as fiercely as if it had been deliberately fired with kindling. Lack of fire-safe housekeeping has doomed this house to destruction. In the other house, with its better, safer housekeeping readily extinguished afterward. Damage? Yes, but the house still stands. One house standing, one house leveled, both painted and cleaned up outside. Identical houses, except for inside conditions and housekeeping. Now, our third test. Three identical...
Age was born. There is no denying that since that moment, the shadow of the atom bomb has been across all our lives. All men of goodwill earnestly hope that a realistic control of atomic weapons can and will be achieved. Meanwhile, good sense requires that all of us prepare for any eventuality. But wisdom demands, too, that we take time to understand this force. Because here, in fact, is the answer to a dream as old as man himself. A giant of limitless power at man's command. And where was it science found that giant? In the atom. A particle so infinitely small that it takes over 100 billion atoms to make up the head of a pin. Just as other millions and quadrillions of atoms are the tiny building blocks which make up everything in the world. Ships, and shoes, and sealing wax, and cabbages and kings. Although no one has ever seen an atom, scientists have learned a great deal about how they behave, and there are widely accepted theories as to what they're like. Let's start by meeting a leading authority on the subject, Dr. Atom. Now, observing the professor himself, we can see that his structure resembles, in many ways, something almost as vast as the atom is small. The solar system. And there are certain similarities. His is the center, with electrons in surrounding orbits. But whereas the planet's movement, trons, is slightly different, there are other differences, too. Hey, hold it! Thank you. Now, the solar system together is electrical. The electrons, which are negative, are attracted by the protons, which are positive, and vice versa. But here in the nucleus are other particles with no electrical charge, called neutrons. Very important characters, too, as we shall see. And equally important when it comes to atomic energy is what scientists call the atom's binding force. It's a kind of cosmic glue holding the nucleus together. This, then, is a single atom. But certainly not all atoms are alike. There are in nature more than 90 basic elements, which is science's term for families of atoms. To scientists, the atoms of the individual atom families, or elements, are identified by number, that is, the number of protons, or positive charges, in their nucleus. And they vary all the way from hydrogen, which has just one proton, to oxygen, with 8 protons, to gold, he's rich with 79, finally, on to the heaviest of all natural elements, uranium, with 92 protons. Now, within each element, or family of atoms, there can be different members, each one having the same number of protons, but differing in the number of neutrons. The total of an atom's protons and neutrons is its atomic weight. Thus, in natural uranium, we have U-234, U-235, and U-238. These different members of the same element or atom family, science calls isotopes. Some elements, tin for instance, have a great many isotopes. Others, like aluminum, are lone wolves with just one. Now, most atoms of most elements are content with their lot in life. We speak of them as being stable. But others are busy day and night, being what science calls radioactive. Like radium, throwing off powerful rays along with some of its neutrons and protons, until it actually alters its own nuclear structure and changes to another family, and then to another, until it does become stable at last. This spontaneous changing of elements is called natural transmutation. Its discovery gave men of science an idea. If an atom could change itself, why couldn't man change an atom? Using as bullets the very particles which radium threw off, a noted British scientist bombarded nitrogen and converted it to oxygen. In terms of individual atoms, this is what happened. The radium nucleus threw off an alpha particle consisting of two protons and two neutrons. One of the protons was absorbed into the nitrogen nucleus, turning it to oxygen. This was artificial transmutation, man changing the elements. From that first experiment, others by the thousands followed as scientists devised ever more powerful particle accelerators, commonly called atom smashers, to transmute more and more kinds of atoms, all scientifically important but hardly world-shaking. Then, in 1939, some scientists were experimenting with transmutation of uranium. What would happen, they wondered, if they fired a neutron at a uranium nucleus, already the heaviest in nature? Why not try? So they tried. And the result? Nuclear fission. Instead of a minor change, the atom split in two. Truly a discovery to change the world. For what had happened when the uranium atom split was a kind of double miracle of science. Half of the miracle concerned that binding force we spoke of before, that kind of cosmic glue which holds the atom's nucleus together. We still don't know all about that binding force yet, but we do know it is equivalent to mass. Therefore, we may speak of it as having a kind of weight of its own. Now, the two atoms into which a uranium atom splits also have binding force. But for some reason, it takes less of that glue to hold them together, and in the process of fission, a tiny fraction is left over. What happens to it? It explodes as energy, proving Einstein's theory that mass and energy are really the same. But we spoke of a double miracle. To understand the second one, let's slow down that fission a million or so times. A single particle starts the reaction, splitting the uranium atom. Here now is the release of energy as heat and blast. Here are powerful rays being given off, similar to X-rays. But here are free neutrons driven out with tremendous speed. And provided there is sufficient U-235 present, what science calls a critical mass, those neutrons bombard other uranium atoms, causing them to split and split still others. The result? A chain reaction. Over a million billion billion atoms exploding within 2 seconds. And the force? It would take Yankee Stadium full of dynamite to equal the energy released in the complete fission of an amount of U-235 the size of a baseball. With this discovery, at the time the free world faced a war for survival, it was little wonder the first thought was a weapon. But how to obtain enough material for even a single bomb? Only a small fraction of natural uranium is the U-235 isotope, which will fission in a chain reaction. And to separate enough U-235 quickly enough seemed all but impossible. But the impossible became reality as industry, labor, science, and the military combined their efforts to build Oak Ridge, where enough U-235 was separated to build the first atomic bomb. At Hanford, Washington, another impossible project proved possible when a huge plant was built for the mass production of the artificial element plutonium. This process involves what may be called the furnace of atomic energy, the reactor pile. Here is a structure or pile of graphite blocks. In the reactor are placed rods of natural uranium containing both U-235 and U-238. As U-235 begins to fission, the graphite slows down the free neutrons and some of them hit other U-235 atoms, keeping the chain reaction going. But others of those slowed down neutrons hit U-238 atoms. And here's what happens. Remember, we said that U-238 wouldn't support a chain reaction. However, it will capture neutrons from U-235 fission and start a process which converts the U-238 first to neptunium, then to plutonium. And plutonium will fission in chain reaction. Thus, the reactor itself is a source of atomic fuel. Besides producing plutonium, the nuclear reactor makes possible two very important peacetime uses of atomic energy. Remember that the chain reaction process in the reactor creates tremendous heat, which scientists have learned how to control. Thus, a reactor may be substituted in many industrial applications where heat is now provided by coal or petroleum. But such uses in the foreseeable future are limited. For one thing, a reactor pile must be shielded to protect the workers around it from dangerous radiation. And this shielding adds tremendous weight. However, an atomic energy power plant has already proved feasible. The future supplying of electric power to entire cities is far from impossible. While nuclear power in locomotives, submarines, ships, and even very large airplanes may all but revolutionize future transportation on land, sea, and air. But perhaps the most valuable byproduct of the nation's reactor piles is radioactive isotopes. Research has revealed that many elements not naturally radioactive became so when placed in a nuclear reactor. And these isotopes, working as tracers with such measuring devices as a Geiger counter, became invisible detectives, aiding the cause of science in many different fields. In agriculture, isotopes are now used to test such things as the effect of fertilizers on plant growth and the proper timing for their use, helping to assure bigger and better yields from tomorrow's farms. In industry, isotopes have found literally hundreds of new uses, such as the automatic thickness control of sheet aluminum, saving hundreds of man-hours of labor and assuring accuracy never before possible. In the fields of medicine and biochemistry, isotopes are performing near miracles of diagnosis and discovery. With radioactive sodium, doctors are solving more of the seeming mysteries of heart disease and circulatory disturbances. Radioactive phosphorus has been used to locate tumors in the brain and greatly simplify operations for their removal. Iodine-131 finds one of many uses in revealing conditions of the thyroid, and there are many more. New ways of using isotopes are being discovered constantly through the tireless work of modern pioneers in such fields as chemistry, metallurgy, medicine, and biology. Truly, the superpower which man has released from within the atom's heart is not one, but many giants. One is the warrior, the destroyer. Another is the engineer seeking to provide vast quantities of energy to run the world's machines. Another is the farmer helping to better feed tomorrow's world. Still another is the healer helping to diagnose and cure the sick. And the last is the research worker working on in the fields of pure science to reveal more of the mysteries of the universe. But all are within man's power, subject to his command. On man's wisdom, on his firmness in the use of that power, depends now the future of his children and his children's children in the new world of the atomic age.
In the picture we are about to see, we must remember that the explosive power of atomic bombs used in this test was in the kiloton range. The explosive power of today's hydrogen bomb is measured in terms of megatons. What does that mean to us? It's a matter of practical application. It takes 1,000 kilotons to equal 1 megaton. And by applying the scaling laws, the proportionate comparative effects of a larger bomb can be determined. The A-bomb exploded here was rated at approximately 30 kilotons. For comparison, let's use a 20 megaton H-bomb. The 20 megaton bomb, therefore, would be 667 times as strong as a 30 kiloton bomb. The relationship between distance for any given pressure and the size of nuclear weapons follows the cube root scaling law. So theoretically, a hydrogen bomb of 20 megatons at approximately 8.5 miles would have about the same destructive power as an atomic bomb of 30 kilotons at 1 mile. In this test, many of the structures were approximately 1 mile from ground zero. In the case of a 20 megaton H-bomb explosion, most of these structures undoubtedly would be obliterated. And actually, at a distance of 8.5 to 9 miles from ground zero, with the longer duration of blast pressure, we could expect to find conditions even more severe than those at 1 mile from ground zero in this test. This atomic test, although depicting the severe effects of a nuclear weapon, does not reflect the extent and severity of destruction that would result from a nuclear weapon in the multi-megaton range.
The Atomic Energy Commission's Nevada test site, I covered the story of Operation Cube, a program to test the effects of an atomic blast upon the things we use in our everyday lives.
Operation Q, the atomic test program of the Federal Civil Defense Administration, as seen by Joan Cowan, reporter.
I had to see Operation Q through many eyes, not only my own, but as a reporter through the eyes of the average American man and woman. I arrived at Civil Defense Headquarters the day before the explosion was scheduled to take place and checked in at once with the official who was to brief me about the test. To give me a perspective of the entire layout, a member of the civil defense staff showed me a carefully prepared model of the site. The scope of the test and the detailed care with which it had been planned amazed me as I listened to the explanation.
We begin with the question of shelter, for shelter might save our lives if we were far enough away from ground zero. If so, what kinds of shelter are effective? Several kinds are to be tested, from elaborate industrial shelters to the box-type shelter in the corner room of the basement. This type would give more room for a family, especially if it were necessary to remain there for several days. In this frame house without a basement, at the 4,700-foot line, we will test a bathroom shelter built of reinforced concrete. The entrance door and outside window covering are designed to resist blast.
I asked about the possible loss of utilities and what this would mean to survivors. No electricity for running a home or an industrial plant.
Loss of power may be one of our biggest problems after an attack. Power poles, power lines, pole transformers, and complete substations are to be tested by the Edison Institute. How will they withstand this blast? How long will it take to make repairs? How soon can service be reestablished? These are things we hope to learn from the test. One complete transformer substation has been erected relatively close to the shot tower.
A second substation and power lines have been placed at a much greater distance from the tower.
Thinking about news during an atomic attack, I asked about radio towers.
Two kinds are to be tested. One tower is self-supporting without guy wires. The other has supporting cables. Both types are very common. Nearby, a complete radio transmitter will actually broadcast from tape before the shot to be picked up by radios in the test houses. Both liquefied petroleum and natural gas facilities will be tested. Will the fittings and connections stand the test? Will there be fires? All equipment is installed and checked by technical experts from the LP Gas Association and the American Gas Association. An 18,000-gallon supply tank, partially filled with propane and complete with feed pipes. A weighing and storage house and delivery platform have been erected on the test site.
I was anxious to learn all I could about the various types of houses to be tested.
Five types are prepared for exposure to the blast and heat of this atomic explosion. First, a single-story frame rambler without basement built on a concrete slab. Second, a two-story masonry with basement constructed of brick backed with 4-inch cinder blocks. Third, a house of 8-inch concrete blocks reinforced with steel. The fourth type is a single-story rambler made of precast lightweight concrete. Walls and roof panels were joined by welding steel lugs. The fifth, at the 5,500-foot line, is a redesigned house similar to one previously tested. This new design provides additional strength at a cost increase of approximately 10%. That's the real purpose of testing these houses, to find their weak points. Through the cooperation of the furniture and appliance industries, household furnishings were installed in the houses. Mannequin families supplied by private industry are to represent Mr. and Mrs. America.
Interior home furnishings donated by industry are complete in every detail. I looked at the mannequin sitting about so indifferently. Naturally, I was very interested in preparations for the testing of textiles and synthetic fabrics.
Rows of mannequins were set up in the open facing the blast. Each item of clothing and each color had been carefully selected to give much-needed survival information.
I was especially interested in the food test program. Canned and packaged foods are to be tested. As a mother and housewife, this appealed to me. I had several questions to ask. Would food in the average home be safe to eat after a blast?
Food testing in Operation Q is planned to answer this and other vital questions. Some foods are to be tested in the house, stored in the usual way. Other foods, including fresh meats, butter, and similar perishables, are to be tested just below the level of the ground at three positions along the main test line. This will expose the food to high-intensity radiation without risking destruction of the containers. Test items include sterilized foods packaged in cartons, metal, and glass. All will be exposed according to plan to give us the most survival information.
The night of the actual explosion, or rather early in the morning, came at last. On Media Hill, television equipment was ready to bring the test into homes from coast to coast. Reporters, commentators, military and civil defense observers all had a purpose, to study the results of this explosion. At a position a mile forward from Media Hill, the Civil Defense Field Exercise Group had assembled with their equipment. A small group of civil defense volunteers were to occupy a trench relatively close to ground zero. On Media Hill, where I remain, there was hot coffee, last-minute briefings, and more waiting. But it seemed no time at all before the loudspeaker warned,
H-minus 1 minute. Put on your goggles. Observers without goggles must face away from the blast.
On the silent desert, the test objects waited.
H-minus 10 seconds. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
Elapsed before we were permitted to view at first hand the results of the explosion.
Let's see how the blast affected the houses. This is what remained of the masonry house that was not reinforced. This is the house constructed of reinforced concrete blocks after the explosion. Although the redesigned two-story frame house was severely damaged, the structural improvements had strengthened its resistance considerably. As seen here, although basement shelters offered some degree of protection, they cannot be depended upon completely in potential blast areas. The reinforced bathroom shelter was standing intact beneath the ruins of the house, so this type also offered some degree of protection. The upper section of one unguided radio tower collapsed from the tremendous force of the blast. The guide tower was slightly twisted by a power pole which fell across one of the guy wires. Within the concrete radio house, equipment had been shaken up. But as soon as power was restored, the transmitter resumed broadcasting. The 18,000-gallon tank of liquefied petroleum gas was undamaged. Tests showed that even the connections were intact. The weighing and storage house was scattered across the desert, but the consumer-sized tanks were unharmed. Power lines and transformers suffered some damage, but most of the power poles were still standing or could be repaired. The power substation was not seriously harmed. Edison Institute personnel tested all lines and found the station to be operative. The food and cases of canned goods were taken away for laboratory tests.
Do you remember this young lady? This tattoo mark was left beneath the dark pattern. And this young man, this is how the blast charred and faded the outer layer of his new dark suit. During all this activity, the mass feeding group was improvising to feed the test observers. I particularly remember some roast beef. It was done to perfection and roasted in cans which could have been salvaged from demolished buildings. I watched the people eating and realized that mass feeding is an important job in civil defense. I took a last look at the debris and devastation. This time it was only a test, a well-planned test, not a real attack. It was a test of the things we use in everyday life.
Many lessons were learned from this test that affect civil defense planning. And it must be borne in mind that multi-megaton weapons would result in much greater damage over a larger area. All these factors must be considered as we plan for the survival of our homes, our families, and our nation in the nuclear age. Operation Q was the name given the Nevada test in 1955, designed to explore the effects of small nuclear weapons upon buildings, towers, and equipment of many kinds. The nuclear device used was comparatively small. It had an explosive force of 30 kilotons, equivalent to 30,000 tons of TNT, whereas some modern thermonuclear weapons are in the 20 megaton range, 20 million tons, more than 600 times as powerful as the bomb shown here, and with a much wider radius of destruction. In this test, many of the structures damaged by the 30 kiloton bomb were approximately 1 mile from ground zero. With a 20 megaton blast, they probably would be obliterated, and comparable damage would occur out to a distance of at least 8.5 or 9 miles. Therefore, while Operation Q was valuable for research and test purposes, it does not reflect the full severity of today's larger thermonuclear weapons with their associated fallout hazard.
Energy Commission's Nevada test site, I covered the story of Operation Q, a program to test the effects of an atomic blast upon the things we use in our everyday lives. I wanted to see Operation Q through my own eyes and through the eyes of the average citizen. I arrived at Civil Defense Headquarters the day before the explosion was scheduled to take place and checked in at once with an official for a briefing on the test. To give me a perspective of the entire test layout, a member of the Civil Defense staff showed me a carefully prepared model of the site. He explained the scope of the test and the detailed care with which it had been planned.
We begin with the question of shelter, for shelter might save the lives of those far enough from ground zero. But what kinds of shelter are effective? Several types are to be tested, from elaborate industrial shelters to a box-like family shelter in the corner room of a basement. In this frame house without a basement, at the 4,700-foot line, we will test a bathroom shelter built of reinforced concrete. The entrance door and outside window covering are designed to resist blast. Loss of power may be one of the biggest problems after an attack. Power poles, power lines, pole transformers, and complete substations are to be tested by the Edison Institute. We hope to learn the answers to these questions. How will they withstand this blast? How long will it take to make repairs? How soon can service be reestablished? One complete transformer substation has been erected relatively close to the shot tower. A second substation and power lines have been placed at a much greater distance from the tower. Two kinds of radio towers are to be tested. One tower is self-supporting without guy wires, and the other has supporting cables. Both types are very common. Nearby, a complete radio transmitter will actually broadcast from tape before the shot to be picked up by radios in the test houses. Both liquefied petroleum and natural gas facilities will be tested. Our questions: will the fittings and connections stand the test? Will there be fires? All equipment is installed and checked by experts from the LP Gas Association and the American Gas Association. This is an 18,000-gallon supply tank, partially filled with propane and complete with feed pipes.
Here, a weighing and storage house and delivery platform have been erected on the test site.
I was eager to learn all I could about the various types of houses to be tested.
Five types are to be exposed to the blast and heat of this atomic explosion. First, a single-story frame rambler without basement, built on a concrete slab. Second, a two-story masonry home with basement, constructed of brick, backed with foreign cinder block. Third, a house of 8-inch concrete blocks, reinforced with steel. A fourth is a single-story rambler made of precast lightweight concrete. Walls and roof panels are joined by steel lugs. The fifth, at a 5,500-foot line, is a house similar to one previously tested in 1950, but a new design provides additional strength at a cost increase of approximately 10%. That's the real purpose of testing these houses, to find their weak points.
Through the cooperation of the furniture and appliance industries, household furnishings were installed in the houses. Mannequin families were supplied by private industry. Interior home furnishings, also donated by industry, were complete in every detail. Textiles and synthetic fabrics were also to be tested.
Rows of mannequins are set up in the open facing the blast. Each item of clothing and each color has been carefully selected.
As a mother and housewife, I was particularly interested in the food test program, a test that included canned and packaged foods.
Some foods are to be tested in the house, stored in the usual way. Other foods, including fresh meats, butter, and similar perishables, are to be tested just below the level of the ground at three positions along the main test line. This will expose the food to high-intensity radiation without risking destruction of the containers. Test items include sterilized foods packaged in cartons, metal, and glass. All will be exposed according to plan to give us the most information.
The night of the actual explosion, or rather early in the morning, finally came. On Media Hill, television equipment was positioned. Reporters, commentators, military and civil defense observers all had one purpose, to study the results of this explosion. At a position a mile forward from Media Hill, the Civil Defense Field Exercise Group had assembled with their equipment. A small group of civil defense volunteers were to occupy a trench relatively close to ground zero. On Media Hill, where I remained, there was hot coffee, last-minute briefings, and more waiting.
H-1 minute. Put on your goggles. Observers without goggles must face away from the blast.
On the silent desert, the test objects waited.
H-minus 10 seconds. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
24 hours elapsed before we were permitted to view at first hand the results of the explosion.
This is what remained of the masonry house that was not reinforced. This is the house constructed of reinforced concrete blocks after the explosion. Although the redesigned two-story frame house was severely damaged, the structural improvements had strengthened its resistance considerably. The basement shelter had offered some degree of protection. The reinforced bathroom shelter was standing intact beneath the ruins of the house, so this type also offered some degree of protection. The upper section of one unguided radio tower collapsed from the tremendous force of the blast. The guide tower was slightly twisted by a power pole which fell across one of the guy wires. Within the concrete radio house, equipment had been shaken up. But as soon as power was restored, the transmitter resumed broadcasting. The 18,000-gallon tank of liquefied petroleum gas was undamaged. The connections were intact. The weighing and storage house was scattered across the desert, but the consumer-sized tanks were unharmed. Power lines and transformers suffered some damage, but most of the power poles were still standing or could be repaired. The power substation was not seriously harmed. Edison Institute experts tested all lines and found the station to be operative. The food and cases of canned goods were taken away for laboratory tests.
A tattoo mark was left beneath the dark pattern of this dress. The blast charred and faded the outer layer of this dark suit. During all this activity, the mass feeding group had been improvising to feed the test observers. These cans could have been salvaged from demolished buildings and used for preparing meat. As I watched the people eating, I realized that mass feeding would be an important job for civil defense. I took a last look at the debris and devastation. This time, it was only a test, a well-planned test, not a real attack. It was a test of the things we use in everyday life.
Multi-megaton weapons would result in much greater damage over a larger area. But many lessons were learned from this test that have affected civil defense planning. All these factors must be considered as we plan for the survival of our homes, our families, and our nation in the nuclear age. Of our times, the fact that atom bombs may someday be dropped on our cities, and let us prepare for survival, understanding the weapon that threatens us. An atom bomb destroys or injures in three ways: by blast, heat, and radioactivity. The blast of an atom bomb is its most important destructive agent.
In Japan, whole buildings were flattened by its force. However, many buildings of sturdy construction, even though close to the explosion, remained standing. The principal dangers of blast are flying glass and debris. The fires it may start, and the danger of being crushed in collapsing buildings. The atom bomb destroys by heat. People caught in the open as far as 2 miles away suffered flash burns. Yet, protection could have been easily achieved. Here, a bridge post and rail shielded the surface behind it. Any solid material afforded similar protection. The third weapon of the bomb is radioactivity, thrown off at the instant of explosion. However, the majority of people exposed to radiation recovered completely, including a large percentage of those who suffered serious radiation sickness. Today, they lead normal lives. They bear children. Their children are normal. These, then, are the weapons of the atom bomb that we must protect against: blast, heat, and radioactivity. Our cities are prime targets for atomic attack, but mass evacuation would be disastrous. An enemy would like nothing better than to have us leave our cities empty and unproductive. If an emergency should come, our factories will be battle stations. Production must go on if we are to win. Our offices and homes will also be posts of duty, not to be deserted. With the knowledge of the first atomic explosions to guide us, our chances for survival will be far better than those of the people of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, if we act on our knowledge and are prepared. The first job is to look over your own home for shelter possibilities. If you live in a private home that is well built, the cellar is the safest place to be. The lower you get, the more barriers there are likely to be against blast, heat, and radioactivity. Select the basement wall nearest the probable target area of your city. If the house is blown over, it will most likely fall away from this wall. If you have a workbench or strong table big enough to get under, move it into your shelter area near a wall or strong supporting column. If the time comes when you actually have to take shelter, lie under the table. If you live in a home that has no basement, choose a shelter area without windows on the ground floor. An interior hallway is probably best. In time of emergency, the shelter area should be cleared of mirrors and other objects that might cause injury. If you live in an apartment house, rules for taking shelter will be posted in your building. Learn them. Also, learn the location of public shelters in areas where you work or frequently visit. There are many things you can begin doing right now. Fireproof housekeeping is one. So clean up that attic. Keep waste in covered containers. Don't let trash pile up in the yard. Set aside a small supply of canned goods. They're safe from radioactivity. Have a good flashlight on hand. Electric lights may go out. Keep a first aid kit and learn how to stop bleeding. Make a habit of keeping a bottle of fresh water handy. A radio will be important for receiving vital instructions. Finally, prepare the shelter area and collect all necessary shelter equipment. In case of an actual raid or test drill, the alert will be a warbling siren blast lasting 3 minutes. Once you hear this, act fast. Down the shades or blinds and close the drapes against flying glass. Turn off the burners of your gas or electric stove. Disconnect any heating elements, such as electric iron, hot plates, or bathroom heaters. outside doors, but leave them unlocked. Turn off the gas or oil burners. Taking shelter may be a race against time, even when you have some advance warning. But possibly, there may be no time. An attack could come without warning. The sky would suddenly light up. If a doorway is right at hand, use it. If the nearest shelter is more than a couple of steps away, fall to the ground immediately. Flying glass and debris are immediate dangers, so stay where you are until you're sure it's safe to move. If you are at home when a surprise attack occurs, crawl beneath a table if it is very near, or drop to the floor with your back to the window. The immediate danger is over in about a minute, unless the explosion occurred near the ground or water. In this case, radioactive materials are trapped in the particles of dirt or water thrown up by the explosion. When these particles fall back to Earth, they may be dangerous. So get indoors immediately after a ground-level explosion. Cover broken windows against radioactive dust with blankets or cardboard. Civil defense radiological teams, equipped with radiation survey meters, will check on contamination in any bombed area. Stay under cover until you hear officially that it is safe outside. If you have been exposed to radioactive dust, wash the exposed areas. Pay particular attention to your hair. Get all the dirt from under your fingernails. If the people of Hiroshima and Nagasaki had known what we know about civil defense, thousands of lives would have been saved. Yes, the knowledge is ours, and preparation can mean survival for you. So act now. Someday your life may depend on it.